Good morning and a very warm welcome to our service. Although we can't meet in person, it's good to be with you once again and to bring the greetings of my own church in Kings Park. As we come together and worship whether you're a member of Blackburn and Seafield, any other church, or no church at all, may we each experience something of the Lord's presence as he binds us together in his love. I'm pleased to announce that the church is open next week, which is Palm Sunday, at 11 and 12. So please check your tally lamp for details and information about Holy Week. And can I remind you to please vote for Blackburn and Seafield's new project by emailing westlothiangov.uk/Blackburn Community-Choices or telephoning 01506 281101, and the details are in the bulletin on page 14. That telephone number can be reached between 10 and 12 and 2 and 4. There are a few ways you can keep in touch with the church family on Zoom. Stepping Stones this afternoon from at 1 p.m. for children. Pizza and Jesus on this evening from 7 p.m. for primary 7 to 6. Senior 6, the Bible study on Monday evening at 7 p.m, coffee morning 10:15 Wednesday, and the prayer service at 11 a.m. Wednesday morning. And if you need details, please phone or email Sandra on 0709 719 676 242 or sandraboyd.bofa@btopenworld.com. You have written your law upon our hearts and inscribed your love upon our lives. You have made yourself known to us in sign and symbol, in still small voice, and in the centre of our souls through the song of your Spirit. So we come, whether gathered or scattered, we come to worship you, for we are your people and you are our God. As we look forward to being back together and joining worship and singing, let's rest our weary souls as we reflect on our first hymn this morning, O Love That Will Not Let Me Go. together in fear. Let's pray. God, our Creator, we thank you that you sent your Son Jesus and gifted us with the Holy Spirit. As we come humbly before you to offer this time of worship, you have made known to us through the heavens and earth and all that they reveal of you. You are also made known to us through Jesus, your Son, who reveals your love for us, and through the Holy Spirit, who reveals your ongoing desire for a relationship with us, and who guides us in your way. We are honoured to be invited to sit at your table, to be co-creators with you, to grow in love for you and to share that love with other people. Forgive us, Lord, for those times when we have messed up, when we have failed to love or share. Forgive us, Lord, for our human frailty, our need to cling to our own ego, or to feed our dark side. And in this moment of silence, we bring to you our own faults and failings. Lord, give us a desire to return to you in a full relationship and courage to continue the work Jesus began and many sins have attended to in his name. And hear us now as we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 31 to 34. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt. Because they broke my covenant, though I was husband to them, declares the Lord. This is the covenant I will make with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbour or say to one another, know the Lord, because they will know me, from the least to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will give their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. And then from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 to 33, Jesus predicts his death. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. Sir, they said, we would like to see Jesus. And Philip went to tell Andrew, and Andrew and Philip in turn told Jesus. Jesus replied, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honour the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment of this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out, and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. Amen, and may God bless these readings from his holy word. So let's reflect now on that death as we listen to our second hymn, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. Jesus was always surprising them. They zigged, he zagged. Every time the disciples thought they had Jesus pinned down, he did something unpredictable. But they sent their expectations into a tailspin. So let's look first at the disciples' expectations. Next time we will celebrate the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. You remember that happy occasion when Jesus entered the great city of Jerusalem and the townspeople came out to cheer him. They threw palm branches, a symbol of victory, in his path. I wonder what the disciples thought of all the hoopla. They probably thought something along these lines. Hey, this is great. We're finally getting some respect around here. All our hard work and sacrifice are paying off. People are coming around to Jesus' view of things. Here in Scotland, it looks like we'll be going to the polls in May, and although candidacy and public meetings will be curtailed, we'll no doubt be subject to endless opinion polls of how the parties are doing. Jesus would have garnered a great score in any public opinion poll if such a thing had existed in his day. According to the polls, it's time for the disciples to begin campaigning for that new kingdom the Master's always talking about. Time to get their candidates' message out there. And what better place to do it than Jerusalem, the largest and most cosmopolitan city in the region? Jesus sure has savvy. He knows exactly how to work a crowd. He must have planned this all along. No doubt, all this was in the disciples' minds. This, for them, was their hour of victory, the day they had been waiting for. And their expectations were only heightened when they heard the Master say, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Yes, that's it, they thought. Finally, it seemed they were on the same page with their Lord. This seemed to fit perfectly with all they had been waiting for. For Jesus, it was that moment when the last sand falls from the hourglass. No time left for the development of new disciples. No time left for miracles to convince the people. No time left for debates with religious leaders. No time left. The passion is upon him. But then Jesus zigs where they expected a zag. "Very truly I tell you," he says, "unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." "Oh, Jesus," think the disciples with exasperation, "here you go again." And suddenly the disciples get that sinking feeling in the pit of their stomach. Why does Jesus have to make everything so hard? Why can't he just relax and enjoy the moment? He's never been more powerful and more popular than he is now. Why can't he leave well alone? Can't he just muster up a rebel army, take over the throne, and name himself king? After all, this is the man who could walk in water and raise the dead. Why doesn't he just use a little bit of that power for his own ends? What? If it fruit falls, if it dies, what's he talking about? Jesus had said, "Unless a grain of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." He then went on to explain what it meant. The man who loves his life will lose it, while the man who hates his life in this world will keep it. It's true in life, isn't it? If we're going to get anything out of it, we have to invest in ourselves. Or invest in ourselves in it. Do you remember the second to the last album by the Beatles? It was called Abbey Road. And even the folk who never heard it probably remember the picture of the Fab Four walking across that pedestrian crossing. And for many, it was their best. The last song is a little musical reprise called The End. It's the last lyrical statement that Beatles make on that album. And it went, "And in the end, the love you take is equal to the love you make." And the truth of this is written in creation. It's evident for everyone to see. It's even found in something as small as a grain of wheat. A seed. I wonder how many remember the film Mr. Holland's Opus, starring Richard Dreyfuss. Mr. Holland dreamed of being a composer, but a new baby in the family caused him to re-evaluate. So he found a job at a high school teaching. And he would spend his spare time writing, composing music. But life crashed in again, and the overwhelming duties of teaching forced him to choose his dream symphony or his student's education. And he tried to continue his writing, but slowly the independent composer dies to the teacher. His heart was broken, but he fulfilled his obligations. Out of the death of his dreams came fulfillment of another. He had composed his opus, not on paper, but in the lives of his students. A brilliant symphony composed of individual lives that he encouraged and nurtured through his teaching. Is this not what Jesus was getting at? When a grain of wheat falls to the earth and dies, it surrenders to new life and bears new fruit. But it doesn't stop there. Those who love their life will lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. But before the disciples can distance themselves from Jesus' words, he confronts them. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honour. For the disciples, this is their critical moment. It will be a model for them and the rest of their lives. Are they willing to follow Jesus and serve as he has done? Whoever serves me must follow me, Jesus said. And where I am, my servant will also be. Next week is the highlight of Lent, where we relive along with Christians all over the world the crucifixion and the resurrection of our Lord. It was a critical moment then for his disciples, and it's a critical moment now for all of today's disciples. So we have to be honest with ourselves. Gathered together in worship when we can, or sitting in the comfort of our own homes, do we intend to follow Jesus? Then we must serve. Do we want the secret of a spiritually alive church? It's serving the one who served us. We look at the promises of eternal life and unimaginable glory, and like the disciples, we say, Lord, I'll follow you there. When we face Jesus' command to serve the poor and needy, to go into all the world to spread his message, to take up our own cross and die to self, just maybe, we aren't quite so sure. John Wesley wrote to his people called Methodists the following rule of conduct. Do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can and in all the places you can, in all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. This is the meaning of the Passion. The crucifixion of Jesus is God's conduct towards us. It is the rule for our conduct toward one another's lives, as long as we shall live. In one installment of the comic strip Hagar the Horrible, and honestly I don't spend all my time watching films or reading comic strips, but Hagar confronts his not-so-great sidekick, Lucky Eddie. I need a second in command, Hagar bellows. Can you say yes or no with authority? And Lucky Eddie shouts back, yes or no with authority? And Hagar says to himself, I think I'm going to be sick. The best thing we can say about Lucky Eddie is that he's eager to please. But Jesus requires more from his followers than being eager to please. Jesus needs people who can say yes with authority. Yes, I'm willing to put you first in my life. Yes, I'm willing to die of my own self and my own agenda. Yes, I'm willing to follow you, though it costs me everything. As one well-known minister put it, salvation may be free, but discipleship may cost you everything. Jesus said, my Father will honour the one who serves me. The disciples may have expected one thing, but Jesus gave them another. Jesus wasn't going to use even a little of his power for his own ends. Jesus wasn't going to declare himself king over Jerusalem or over the Jews or even the Roman Empire. Jesus came to serve. And by his death, Jesus broke down the wall between humanity and God. By his death, Jesus fulfilled the new covenant. No longer is the law written in stone tablets, but on the heart. Amen. Let's pray. Loving God, we come before you today with thanksgiving. We are glad to know you through your Son, Jesus. We come to offer our prayers for the world and for all those who are suffering just now. Lord, we are grateful for the relationship we have with you and all it brings us. Excuse me. We pray for anyone who has yet to discover your invitation, or for anyone who has previously turned it down. Lord, may they come to know you and love you. Lord, we are grateful for all the people you have blessed us to know and for all those relationships mean to us. We pray for anyone who has lost touch or fallen out with a friend and who desires to reconnect and reconcile their relationship. Lord, we are grateful for all who give their time and talents to further your kingdom. Elders, readers, ordained local ministers, deacons, parish ministers, pastors, regional and national staff, and those working locally. We pray for all who are discerning a call to serve your church in a new way. May they choose to serve and follow where you lead. Lord, we are grateful for all who serve others in the armed forces, in the medical services, in the fire service, and in a voluntary way through the many charities that help other people. We pray for all who are considering joining a service and for those who use these services and benefit from them. We pray for your people here in Blackburn and Seafield and for your church throughout Scotland and beyond. We pray for Sandra as she enjoys a well-earned break. And in this moment of silence, we offer the people and places we know of where your presence and healing touch are needed today. Lord, thank you for hearing our prayers and for promising to always answer them. Give us patience to wait and courage to serve. Amen. As we close our service this morning, as we reflect on God's amazing love and ask, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? love and to serve our Lord all the days of our lives. And so may the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God our Heavenly Father, and the intimate friendship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, those whom we love, and those whom we find it hard to love, now and forevermore.